it found me at my weakest. Your grace poured out in my despair.
Love could not be overcome. Now death Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is
it is.
give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Every heart that is broken.
Amen. Amen. Well, look, we are excited that you are here this morning. Those of you watching online, Amber, thank you so much for making sure that we got our sound working properly, and so y'all really saved the day in that. Look, for a moment, as we gather together this morning, if you are brand new here, this is an opportunity for us to welcome you. We're glad that you have met us here at the house of the Lord at Westside. We wanted you to know for just a moment that if you would like to fill out a little connect card, those are located in your pew, or you can do a little QR code. This is also time that we're able to give unto the Lord. And so for a moment, as we're shaking hands together, we want to invite you to do that. If you haven't had an opportunity to give yet, you can do those in those boxes or online. As you're shaking hands, though, our kids, I want you to have your attention towards the screen as we just watch a little video. You're shaking hands during that time. So let's shake some hands. Greet each other in the name of the Lord. Tony, go ahead and start that video for me if you don't mind.
Y'all ready? J, give me an E, E, you've got your E, you've got your E, give me an S, S, you've got your S, you got your S, give me a U, U, you've got your U, you've got your U, give me an S, S, you've got your S, you've got your
What's up, Jesus? Amen. Go ahead and be seated for a moment, amen. Keep that playing as they go.
Jesus.
Amen. Well, look, we have wanted this morning just for an opportunity to ask some of these folks who are here that went with us to M4 camp. I'm going to start with Mason, Big Mason. We had like three Masons this week, so it's kind of hard to figure out which one was what. But go ahead, tell us what camp meant to you, and we'll go from there.
All right, so Saturday, we left on Sunday, but Saturday I got a call from Marcus, and I got invited / voluntold that I was going to camp. But if I could go again, I would in a heartbeat. Just seeing 50-something kids in a room worshiping Jesus, and then I even have the chance to talk to this one about becoming a follower of Christ. It was worth it.
Amen, 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 amen. All right, Miss Danielle, share with us if you don't mind.
So going has just been an incredible experience for myself. This was my third year going. The first year I went, it was just 16 children, Brother Marcus, Tony, and myself. And when we went, we had a great experience, but we knew there was something that like was lacking with our children because, you know, other churches, like their kids, every time it was time to pray, they were raising their hand. They knew more books of the Bible and they were quoting more scriptures. And when we came back, Brother Marcus and Tony, they put this plan in place for Wednesday nights that really just dug deeper for our children and let them learn more Bible verses and learn the books of the Bible. And they were just gaining more confidence in praying and taking leadership. So last year when I went, I could tell like it was a huge change in our children. But this year when we went, after all the times and all the craziness of Wednesday night trying to wrangle all these children up, it has really, really paid off because we went with 58, mm-hmm. was it? 58 this time. And our children, our church was the one, our kids were the one raising their hand every chance to pray and quote scripture and know their books of the Bible. And it was just amazing to see the growth in our children and to know that all those Wednesday nights and all the craziness it might seem trying to get all the kids together is really working and paying off. And I'm not even a crier, and for some reason, my eyes kept watering like the whole time just seeing our kids and the growth that they have in Christ. It's really been amazing.
Amen, amen, amen.
Okay, so this was my first time going to camp, and I really just thought, chaperone, okay, fine. I have my group, make sure everybody is together, and I'm good. I feel like we as chaperones really did an excellent job helping one another out because if somebody, you know, if we were always like, where is so-and-so, making sure everybody was together. But I would have to say that the best part for me was at night, even though I was dog tired, it was way past my bedtime, they want to do devotion at night. So our devotion time was, it consisted of me and Miss Kim's room was like first and second graders, I would say. And then the next one over were the older girls. Well, we would get together and you couldn't even tell. They embraced one another. They helped each other find scriptures and everyone was involved. And this one particular devotion that I would like to talk about is, it was Romans 3:23 and Romans 6:23 and Romans 5:8. But basically, we had a paper towel and there was a heart on both sides. And we went around asking, every time I sin, my heart gets a little dirty. And every time a child would say a sin, which I can give you some examples, cussing, lying, stealing, not believing in God, not being a follower of Jesus, murder, abuse, gossiping, being rude, disrespectful, calling names, bullying, disobedience, and spreading rumors. This was things that were mentioned by our children. Every time they mentioned it, Kimberly would mark with a marker on that heart. Then at the end, she put the the paper towel in the water and brought it back out, and all the marker was gone. So it just was showing that Jesus paid the way for our sins and that we are forgiven. That particular lesson hit home for me, for myself as an adult, and I know it was for the children, but also Cameron says a lot to me, Mom, I keep sinning, and I'm so upset with myself because I know I'm disappointing God. This is our children feeling that way, and that's a good thing, you know, but we have to remind them that Jesus has paved the way for our sins, and we just have to keep working on ourselves.
So I'll just share what I shared in Sunday school this morning was that Sunday morning, well, I'll start on Saturday. Saturday I spent a lot of time praying about camp and praying for all the kids. I took the list that we were given and I prayed for y'all name by name, and I prayed for the adults that went name by name, and I was really at peace and excited about going. And then Sunday morning I woke up and I was like, it was like a different person woke up. I did not want to go to camp. I was not excited. I was anxious. I still had not packed everything yet, and it was getting time because we were leaving immediately after church. And Brett was working the night before, and he wasn't home yet. And I texted him. I said, I should not have signed up for this. This was not the right thing. I don't want to go. And but I was committed. I definitely wasn't going to leave them hanging. And I came to practice that morning, to worship practice, and I talked to Miss Melissa and I talked to Miss Nancy, and they were asking, they're like, are you excited? And I was like, no, I'm trying to be, you know, but not really. And Miss Nancy said something to me that I remembered throughout all of camp, and that was, well, you're feeling this way because God is going to do something big. And it was so true. And this morning in Sunday school, we talked about the cost of what it takes to follow what God wants. And I just didn't want to go. It really wasn't going to cost me anything. I had already had the time off of work and, you know, whatever. I had no reason not to want to go. It was just my own feelings. I just didn't want to. But what the blessings were that I got from going and being able to see children give their life to Christ, being able to have conversations with some of the girls about Jesus and seeing our kids worship, that really was just a blessing I can't describe. When you're in worship and there's a song that has no hand motions, which most of the kids' songs do, you know, to keep them engaged, but we were singing a song, and we're actually fixing to sing it this morning. It didn't have motions, but I happened to open my eyes, and one of our kids was standing right in front of us, one of our boys, one of our older boys, and he had his hand raised in worship. And that just, I thought about what Miss Nancy said. Like, I would have missed getting to see this, and it just blessed me so much to be able to see the kids, like they said, working together to help each other find scriptures and just all those just really great things. I'm just so thankful that I went, and thankful that I got to be there with Isaac also.
All right, so we saved the best for last. Amen. All right. So Isaac, you got to hold that microphone like real close to your face and stuff. It doesn't work without that. Let me ask you, what was our theme? Do you remember our theme of this of camp? It's on the shirts and stuff.
Not ashamed.
Not ashamed. I knew that you would know that. So tell me, what did camp mean to you? Like, what was the most meaningful part of camp for you?
The most meaningful part to me was when I went to go talk with Mason and I gave my life to Christ.
Amen. Yeah, and so to see his face, first of all, who didn't want to go until he was told. I didn't really tell him or anything, you know. I did call his mom and I called his grandma and called everybody else. But, but to see his face, to see someone give their life to Christ, and then to see his face, and then when they presented him before his mama at lunch or something, it was at the meal place and all breakfast, it was quite a moment. One of the songs that they sang, and we have several decisions that were made during camp. Those of you who made decisions, as Brother Waylon's going to come and lead us, and the worship team will lead us in this song. It's a song that you probably have heard before, but we're going to do like I want to have an invitation just for our kids. Adults, you'll get an invitation at the end. The Lord always invites us, but we want to just take a special moment. You're going to stand and sing with us. Could y'all mind standing with us for a moment? I'm going to ask today that our chaperones who went with us, if y'all could actually stand at the front here. And so my wife is up there. You got to stay up there. I'm putting you to work this morning, baby girl. I know, thumbs down from the top. But for those who have made decisions during Christ, and listen, some of our boys who had made decisions may not have had an opportunity as well. And so, counselors, if y'all could stand up front, if one of these children that you were involved in, Miss Kim, you got to sing. I'll let you sing. You stay here with your mama and stuff. But for a moment, those who are making decisions for Christ, counselors, as their family comes forward, would you pray for them? And if you're in the, whether it's way up top as you're a child or way up in the front row, if you had made a decision for Christ, we want to celebrate that with you as we sing this song that we sang at camp to talk about what the Lord has done. Amen. So let's sing this song together this morning.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart.
Y'all know the words. Sing this out.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are.
Come on, let's sing that together.
And where you are, Lord, I am free. And holiness is Christ in me.
Sing it one more time.
And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Let's sing together, Lord.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Yeah.
To continue here in a moment to sing and praise the Lord. But I want to make you aware very quickly of some decisions for Christ that have been made over this little camp time. One is, I'd like to introduce you to Madison. Madison, come stand right up here next to me. If you start crying, I'm going to start crying. So this here, so we had the opportunity. I know my wife is crying right now. But Madison came, and after speaking and her family been praying for her, just for a moment, one of the things that Madison said, she said, "I just want to know him more. Like I want to know more about the Lord." And I was like, "Baby girl, that salvation is just the beginning. And you'll want to know him more for the rest of your life." And so it was just amazing to see the Lord move in Madison's life. If you rejoice over this decision that she's made, would you just celebrate that today? Yeah. Well, stand right here. I'll let you go back down with them. Next up is Lexi. Could you? Oh, mercy. She's going to be crying too. Amen. And so this here is this little one and her two siblings and all. This here is Lexi. And so so Lexi had come before me, and when she came, she you know, you look at her and it's like, did they have any sins at all? And it's like, yes, because we all need a Savior. But when she came, it was even before we really started, the preaching hadn't even happened yet. Before even the slow songs, we just got done singing J-E-S-U-S, and you know, they were, but then, you know, the Lord just started moving in her heart. She was already crying before the rest of the time. And so so we had an opportunity to talk about her and her relationship to Christ. And so she prayed to accept the Lord Jesus Christ during camp as well. And all these kids do it. You know, let's face it, we could kind of manipulate the emotions and all that kind of stuff. That's not how this camp works. They are extremely, like, extreme. They don't even do, like, a worship call to worship. They don't even have you come forward. They don't do an altar call. They have opportunities for you as counselors to kind of speak to them. But she gave her life to Christ during that time. So we celebrate with her. Amen. Would you just celebrate with her this morning? And then look, I want to introduce you one more. We've got two others that'll be coming. Okay, Cameron, come stand up here with me real quick. Come right here if you don't mind. Cameron, on Monday, Cameron baptized me. And so we were in this pond, right? Didn't you do that? And so she held my nose and everything, dumped me backwards, and, you know, did it the first time. Brother Drake, she didn't even leave me under too long. And so you know, so she did it, and then she's like, "All right, now you baptize me." I was like, "No, I'm not going to baptize you until this is a real thing." And so so she had been for literally months now. She's like, I'm going to give my life to Jesus. I'm going to give my life to Jesus." And she can be forceful too, huh, baby girl? And so she was like making sure that I knew that she's giving her life to Christ. And so we had waited and just wanted to be patient on the Lord. And then finally, you know, she had prayed, and this girl is wise beyond years. And so so she just prayed to accept Christ. Would you celebrate with her about her decision for the Lord as well? Amen. Now look, as we celebrate with these decisions, the reason why these children know the Bible and the books of the Bible is because of a brilliant idea that Miss Dominique, oh, wait, he was behind me. I knew I kept him up here for a reason. All right, and then this here is Isaac. You've already heard his testimony about what the Lord did in his life. He's been prayed for, and we've just thanked the Lord for what he's done in his life, even those like Brother Mason, who was able to kind of share with him. And so if you celebrate with him and his decision for Christ, would you say amen as well? Amen. And so look, Miss Dominique is going to be leading our children's church this morning, and so as she comes, she's somewhere nearby. And so, yes, ma'am, I knew I'd see you. And so, so they've been learning the books of the Bible, talking about Jesus and the gospel. And so as we celebrate that today, as they are dismissed for children's church, y'all can be seated back to your seats and all. We just celebrate. Y'all got to stand. Now y'all can't sit down. Y'all tried this with me last week and stuff. Y'all ain't sitting down. Just stand for a moment as we just sing this song. We celebrate this. If you go into children's church, have your child come forward as we sing, "I Trust in God, My Savior." Amen.
The beautiful thing about salvation is that no one comes to God without the very Spirit of God drawing them to Himself. And to know that the very Spirit of God is seeking out these little kids is an amazing thought. It's a beautiful thing to watch.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood, and what He did for me on Calvary is more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I know the author of tomorrow is ordered my steps. So this is my story, this is my song. I'm praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior,
amen. You can be seated this morning. Amen. Y'all start breathing. There is something about being able to breathe. There's something about the very fact of the inhale and the exhale of your life to be an opportunity for you to realize that if there's still breath in your lungs, then you have an opportunity to live. If there's still breath in your lungs, then you still have an opportunity to serve. If there's still breath in your lungs, then you have an opportunity to love and cherish and care and be there for one another. I don't know if any of you have ever seen one of these. Anybody ever seen one of these? I have a feeling that some of y'all who grew up in lunchrooms and stuff, that some of y'all who are those kind of people who, I don't like my food to touch. Anybody like that? Do we have some non-food touchers? I don't know what is wrong with y'all. Like, I am mixing my mashed potatoes with my corn and a couple of green bean juice in there. I mean, it is okay to do that. But I realized, because my wife is one of those, like, these kind of people and all, that we were at Camp M4 Camp at Walkaway Springs. They serve you dinner, lunch, breakfast in one of these, but they're the rectangular kind. It has about five little locations, one for your little drink. It's got a little white, you know, little circle in there, one little thing for your dessert, one little, and so they have all of these different compartments. How many of you are glad for compartmentalized little plates like this? Some of y'all who, I saw you, Heidi, I saw that. Now, here's the thing. If you go through, and like one day we had, here's at camp, pork chops. Not the white people kind, but like real pork chops. Mandy made those like kind that you just stick in the oven with a little bit of pepper on there. That's not what we're talking about. I'm talking about like real pork chops and stuff. You know, so these were like, they had pork chops, they had rice, and there was gravy on top. Now Melanie's like, no, that ain't real gravy. That's out the can. I did not care. You put a little pepper on it. It was some amazing gravy that they had on top of this rice. They even had these things, and they are my favorite. It's what you mix in the mashed potatoes. It's peas, the green kind, the little English kind, you know, the mushier the better. And so they had some of these little green peas. They also had some cornbread, you know, beans and cornbread, you know, beans, tomatoes. All right, so they had some cornbread in there, but then they also, you had to have a place for your drink, and then they also had to have a place, while you had all this stuff, they had a place for some peach cobbler. Now, here is the problem when you're at kids' camp. If you get everything that they offer to you, they begin to yell. The people behind the little, you know, buffet line thing, the people behind the little stage thing, the what is that thing called? The window thing where the food is on the other side so that you don't spit all on it. So the people that are working on the other side, if you get everything that they offer to you, they begin to yell. That's what they yell. From top, Curtis, what do they yell? Walk away special. And so it's a privilege for you to be able to get everything that they offer, and they call it walk away special. And so they're yelling the entire time. Now, friends, here's the problem. They offered me 8 different items on a walk away special. It only held about 6 on this plate that they gave me. So I had a crucial decision to make at that time. Do I leave something off? Do I subtract something, or by adding something, do I keep that thing? Because my plate was full, and I wanted some peach cobbler, and they had tea as well. And so somehow, something's going to have to get mixed together in here, my peas onto my mashed potatoes. I had to either take it away or keep adding to it in order for me to have this plate, which this plate was now full. I had to subtract something in order to add something. My plate was full. James chapter 4 is where I'd like for you to turn in your Bible. And in James chapter 4, there's an incident, a story that James shares. And the story that he shares there is actually your story as well. Because just like my plate was full, your plate is full. I got my job compartment, I got my family compartment, I got things that I'm doing with my own life, and I got my health compartment. I've got all of these different segments of my life, and some of you have realized I can't add another thing. I thought when I retired I'd have more time, and now I feel like I am retired, like I'm tired multiple times over and over and over again. I don't know. I've got this thing at my job, and I got these pressures, and something's got to give here. I have too much stuff. My plate is full. Well, James chapter 4, we read about a man whose plate was full. In order to add something more, he had to subtract something. So James chapter 4, starting in verse 13, when you find that honor of the Lord in his word, y'all coming back, right? Good, because I need him later on. James chapter 4, verse 13. In honor of the Lord, thank you for standing with me as we read God's word together. James chapter 4, starting in verse 13, he says, come now, all right, he's talking to some folks, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city, spend a year there, buy and sell and make a profit. Verse 14, whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears, a breath that appears, a moment that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance, and all such boasting is evil. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. Fathers, we gather together in your word this morning. I pray, Lord, that you would speak. Hide us behind the cross of Jesus Christ, that you today would be glorified most of all. We thank you for what you've done this week in the lives of our children. We pray for their parents and their guardians and those that are over them. But Father, this morning, we pray that you would guard our hearts. Help us to listen to you as we respond in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Go ahead and be seated. Now, here is the problem that you and I encounter, that you and I go through. I don't know if you have ever encountered this in your life. The problem that this man encountered was he thought that he was in control of his life. Do you see verse 13? He thought he was in control of his life. You say, what are you talking about? Well, look, he says, come now, today, tomorrow, we'll go to such and such a city. He thought he was in control of the wares. We'll go to such and such a city. He thought he was in control of the winds. We'll spend a year there, today or tomorrow. We'll spend a year there. He thought he was in control of the what's, that he was going to buy and sell and do what he wanted to while he was there. He even thought he was in control of the how, because he was like, well, we're going to get there, and how are we going to make a profit and prosper in this time? And he thought he was even in control of the who, because he says, I will, we will do this here to make those things. The who, the what, the when, the where, the why. This man thought that he was in control of all of those things. He added a lot of those things to his plate. But if you look in verse 13, you'll notice something. You'll notice a certain absence. You'll notice that as he's planning all of these things for the whens and the wheres and the whys and the whos, it's of his life, that there is one thing that he forgot to put into his life. He subtracted out of his life in order to add the other things. You'll notice that the problem was he added the world, but he subtracted God. God was not mentioned in any of his who's, what's, when's, where, why's, and how's. He was not a part of the plan, the process of getting in this journey. God is very noticeably left out of the plans that this man has. What? He says, look, I will do this. He obviously did well for himself, and so he's probably a good guy, and he may have even gone to church, but the problem was this man, in all sense of the word, is what we would call a practical atheist. You say, what are you talking about? It is somebody who may have even believed in God, but God had no bearing on his everyday life. Now listen, you're here on Sunday morning. You're obviously, you know, some of you have read your Bible. You've been to Bible study already. You've taken some time. You obviously have some kind of relationship that says, I ought to be in church on a Sunday morning. But sometimes from Sunday to 24 hours later on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, for some reason, what does happen on Sunday does not transfer to the rest of the week. On Sunday, your words is good. On Monday, you cussing up a crazy storm. On Sunday, you're loving and caring about people. And then on Friday, you're out loving and caring about the wrong people. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, sometimes in life, we end up doing all of these things to where we are just practically on our everyday basis leaving God out. God ain't a part of every plan, process, procedure of our life. He's not in there. And so that's what this man had. He says, I will do this. I will go there. I will make this happen. These are the things of my life. And the Bible says, look, the problem with that in verse 16 is that is boastful, arrogant. And the word that we would use for that is this word called pride. And what the Lord says when he looks at this decision that this man did by leaving God out of the process and the plan and the procedures of his life, God says that right there, my friends, is evil. That right there, my friends, is sin. To leave God out of the very plans and processes, and at the root of all this, it is sin. I heard this song one time. Makai, you don't know this song and stuff. Bobby and I may be the only ones that know this song. The song goes like this. It's my life. It's now or never. I ain't gonna live forever. And then he goes around. He says, I just want to live while I'm alive. My heart is like an what? Open highway. Because who said, Frankie said what? I did it my way. And so and then he says, I just want to live while I'm alive. Why? Because it's my life. Now, Bon Jovi with the hair and the sticky uppy things that he used to have back in the day, you may think to yourself, well, man, I used to jam out that with my 8-track or my CD or what y'all have? Y'all had phonographs and stuff, right, with the big horns and all. So I don't know how you was listening to Bon Jovi back then, but that song has reverberated since he wrote it in some of y'all's hearts thinking, you know what, it's my life. Preacher ain't going to tell me how to get my money or how to spend my time. Preacher ain't going to tell me what to do with my life. If I want to sleep with who I want to sleep with, live however I want to live, if I want to do whatever I want to do, if I want to take my body and do this to it, then nobody is going to tell me why, because it's my life. You don't tell me. You don't control me. You don't own me. And so sometimes we have that same attitude that's out of that song, and that's what this guy had. He says, you know what? I'm in control. I decide who and what and where and why and everything. I'm the one who decides the way that my life shall go. But then the answer comes pretty soon in verse 14, where he says, you know what, you're not in control. Verse 14, he says, whereas you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. Anybody here know what's going to happen tomorrow? Listen, I think there's like a 780 something million dollars on this little Powerball thing. It might even be more, quite close to a billion now. I don't even know what it is. Now, if you already knew the numbers, 7, 4, 12, I don't even know how that thing works. But if you already knew the numbers tomorrow, some of y'all be like, well, I know what tomorrow holds. Give me that number, my birthday, this thing right here. Y'all would already do it. Y'all, you know, well, we'd have a new sanctuary and stuff. If that would happen, y'all would all take care of some stuff. Now, you don't know that. You don't know Powerball numbers. You don't know when you're going to get up and walk out of church and stuff. I mean, you don't know any of you don't know any of that kind of stuff. We don't know the moments, the days, the hours. And so here he says, you think you're in control of the who, what, when, where, why, and how of your life, and you're really not. Whereas your whole life, and he says, you know what, your whole life, what is your life, verse 14 says, it is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Would you store that? I'm going to get back to that at the very end of the sermon. Would you store that idea that your life is like a vapor that is here today and simply gone tomorrow, it vanishes away? Mason, you remember? I don't know if you remember. We were out doing campy stuff with the kids. He looks over at me and he's like, watch this, Brother Marcus. It was, I don't know if it was the dew or if it was cold or whatever, but he did that sign. You know, remember how he used to like, watch, I'm going to smoke. And all of a sudden, what happened? Yeah. That's why I don't smoke anymore. You see all that? Yeah. But, wow, it's vapor. Life is like a vapor. It's a personal example. Would y'all stop? But, and so all of a sudden, whenever he did it, he didn't do that on me, thankfully, but I could. See, I had to do that so you could see the visual effect. He did have his vapor breath come out of his mouth. You could see it in the way it was. I think my head was even like steaming that night and stuff. You could see it was literally like steam coming off my head. Life is like a vapor, and we'll talk about that here in a moment. But he says, look, if you're not in control, then what ought you do? If you don't really control tomorrow, the next day, a year from now, if you're not in control of the who, what, when, where, why, what ought you to do? Well, would you look at verse 15? And some of y'all need to start memorizing this verse in your life. You really like need to write this down. Verse 15 says, instead, you ought to say, not today or tomorrow I'm going to do this. No, instead, you ought to say, if the Lord lives, we shall live and do this or that. He starts with the word the Lord. Now, the Lord means master, ruler, the one who is in control of my life. That is what Lord means. Lord means sovereign in control. The providence hand of God is upon my life. Lord means that he knows what he is doing, that I am nothing but a servant of his. That means that he is the Lord. When it means that he is the Lord, it means that I don't have the right to ever tell the Lord no. It means that I can't tell God what he ought to do with his time, my time, and the time of this world. It means that if he is truly the Lord, that I can't just come up one day and say, God, I set my time schedule. It's my life. I want to do things my way. No, when we begin to realize that he is the Lord, the only act that you give to a Lord, a king, a master, is an act of submission to where you bow down before him. And so he says, look, instead of you thinking you're the Lord of your life, you need to realize that instead of those things, we ought to say, if the Lord does one thing, if the Lord wills. I don't know if you know this, God actually does have a purpose, a plan, and a will for your life. He has desires for how he wants your life to turn out today, tomorrow, 5 years, 10 years from now. God's desire, he has a will for your life when it comes to who he wants you to marry, when it comes to what job you should do, when it comes to how he wants you to live your life. God actually has a will, a purpose, and a plan for your life. And so some of you are probably wondering yourself, well, how do I figure out God's will? I don't have time to go through this entire thing, but there are five things. It's in your hymnal or in your Bible app as well. Those of you watching online, you can check this out later on. But there are five things about God's will that he says, this is what my will is. The first thing is, we begin to see that his will, in 1 Timothy 2:4, his will is that there might be salvation, that you might be saved. You see, you may come here today and you're like, man, I came to this church and this is what happened. And, you know, I had different things in my mind. But God's greatest will for your life, before you can figure out who do I marry and when do I do this and how do I do that and where do I go and when do I do this, your greatest plan and will God has for your life is salvation. You say, what are you talking about? It means that you right now, whether you think you're good or you think you're bad, whether you right now think, well, I'm okay with God. Listen, apart from a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, you are lost and dying and going to a place called hell. That is separation from God for all eternity. So your greatest need this morning to know what is God's will for my life, it is actually to be saved, to give your life to Jesus Christ. And some of you may need to do that. Today, right where you are, if you're watching online or here in person, your greatest decision that you could ever do is to make a decision that you say yes to the Lord. But it's not only salvation, but another part of God's will. 1 Thessalonians 4:3 says, for this is the will of God, your sanctification. Which means that salvation is just the beginning. It is just the beginning of that relationship with God, but then he wants you to become more and more like Christ. Sanctification, that word actually means to be set apart, to be made holy, which means that if I am set apart, I can't just keep living in whatever sin that I'm living, thinking that I'm okay to live like that, that I can just keep on doing the same thing. Are we going to live a perfect life? No, but we ought to try continuously to grow closer to Christ, be more like him. And so you have a will for God's will for your life is that you might be set apart, to be sanctified, to become more and more like Christ. Another part of God's will is, though, is that we ought to bring him a sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. This is God's will for you in Christ Jesus, that in everything give thanks. And when your attitude and your heart is in a place that you know Christ and that he's working in your life, then there ought to be an overflow of thanksgiving, that the breath that you have, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And not only that, but we ought to be satisfied in Christ. If you read through Ephesians, the entire book of Ephesians uses a phrase over and over again. It's called in Christ. And in Christ means that I am in Christ. I have a relationship with him. He is in me and I am in him. And so all of a sudden what happens is that I am satisfied. You can give me anything that the world has to offer, but it won't be as sweet and pleasant, as joyful as it is when I know Jesus Christ. That ought to be the greatest heartbeat of your life. It ought to be the most satisfying thing of knowing him, of growing in Christ, and just being around him. And then the last one is that we ought to saturate, this is God's will for your life, to saturate the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. 1 Peter chapter 2 talks about the fact that, you know what, it's God's will that we should, by doing good, put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. And so God's will is that we are actually used of him to make a difference for the Lord Jesus Christ. Can I tell you, though, if you really want to know what is God's will, how do I figure out who do I marry, what do I do with my time, where do I go, and where do I do business, and all those things, Matthew 6:33 says, seek first the kingdom of what? Of God and his righteousness, and then all these things shall be added unto you as well. You want to know what God's ultimate greatest will for your life is? Is that God's will for you is that you will say, I will to him. Chew on that for a second. God's greatest will for you is that you will say, I will to him. I will serve you. I will give you my life. I will surrender these sins and turn my life to holiness. I will say yes before you even ask me a question. I will do exactly what you have called me to do. Now, when we say that you ought to seek God first, the kingdom of God, some of y'all have this really messed up priority schedule that you think, well, that means, okay, I'm going to put God first. And then afterwards, my family. And then afterwards comes my job. And then afterwards comes my activities. And then afterwards comes this. And so we have kind of set this system up that says, okay, God first, and then this is important, and then that is important, and that is important. That's not what seeking first the kingdom of God means. Seeking first the kingdom of God means I put God first. But then it's God in my family, God in my job, God in my activities, God in my checkbook, God in my time schedule, God in everything. So that way it's not just, well, I got God and I do him on Sundays and then Monday I go to work and then on Tuesday I hang out with the family and I got bowling night on Wednesday and I do this. That is not how God has set this thing up. It is God in everything. He does not just want to be a part of your life. He wants to take over your life. He wants to be every part of your life so that you might come to say, you know what? I have God in every part. The problem is we keep on adding more stuff to our lives. We keep on adding more stuff. Well, you know what, boy, my kid, y'all don't know my child and stuff. My child is the greatest second grade baseball player that you've ever seen. There is no doubt in my mind that this second grader is going to the big leagues one day. And so what do? To add stuff to your life, you have to subtract stuff. So to add stuff when it comes to, I need to add more time, I need to add more focus, I need to add more of this thing. And so this second grader, I need to make sure that they're always here, always there, always there. Well, guess what happens? The more that you add, you've got to subtract. Your plate can only be so full. And those kids' lives, for some of our children, are being run ragged because we are adding more stuff. But the one that gets left out the most of the time is going to be God. I got my sports, but I'm going to leave out God. I got my thing, and I'm going to leave out God. I got my dance, but I'm going to leave out God. I got these activities, but I'm going to leave out God. I got more stuff at my job, but I'm going to leave out God. I got to take care of this thing in my family, but I'm going to leave out God. And sometimes the one that ought to be the first priority in my life, in my activities, in my school, in my kids, in my family, the one that gets left out of that is the Lord. And he says, no, you who say today or tomorrow, I'm going to do this and I'm going to take care of my business this way, the when, where, why, how of my life, that's how I'm going to handle this thing. He says, no, I want to be in every part of that. How many of you guys know you can work more hours at your job and add more stuff, responsibilities at your job, but it's going to cost you something because you got to subtract some stuff. What are you subtracting? Time with my family. Time trying to get to know them better. And so you added more hours and you raised more money, but then you subtracted more time, and that time is irreplaceable. You know, let's face it, whether it comes to whatever activity you have in life, the more you add, the more you're going to subtract. We did Tomiko's funeral. We did her funeral this past week, and I tried to tell y'all that every single breath is a gift. That word says, whereas you do not even know what your life holds, you have no idea. You do not know because your life is like a vapor. Pick one of these out. Pick one of them. Pick any of them out. And think to yourself, this thing here is going to last. Any one of these. Pick one out. And you're thinking to yourself, you know what? This thing right here will last forever. Did Tomiko's funeral, you know what? Someone else is driving her car today. Someone else is living in her house today. Not only is someone else living in her house, but sometimes that coffee shop that she had, someone else is going to get that coffee. And not only that, you know what else is going to happen? One of these days, it'll be just like us. It'll be over. Now you say, what are you talking about, preacher? This is what I've been trying to tell y'all about. This is why we've spent literally weeks on taking advantage of every single breath. Every single breath. I don't know if you can see that from where you are. Every single breath. Mason, can you come here real quick? So yesterday, come here real quick, baby boy. Yesterday, I'm going to lift you right here. Yesterday, I get a phone call. If y'all saw his face up on the screen, this dude knows how to have a lot of fun. He enjoys every part of life. But he is all boy. And sometimes, all boys will do boyish kind of stuff. Maybe you can knock those off up there. And so what happened, I get a phone call that there's been an accident. And Mason, as a boy, playing around, BB guns involved and everything else, what ends up happening, he's a shell casing, right, Michael? A 9mm shell casing. Because he's just being a boy playing around. Well, it did as shell casings will do in a bullet. And part of that, you can't see with his little neck right here, but he's about 50, 60 yards away from the house. And while he's out there playing around, part of that shell casing tears through his skin and finds itself lodging slowly down his neck. This is just what part of his shirt looked like. Literally, it was coming out of his neck as he was speaking. A 6-year-old that he was sitting or playing with out there told him, put pressure on it. And then he walks 50 yards to his house where mama is. And this is just the clean version of it. And this is what happens. He says, everything. You can imagine how quickly things change in a moment. We got to the hospital, they took care of him and everything else, but chewing on a little bit too much, Tina, you know, just chewing on the fact that 50 yards for a kid this size and he's literally gushing blood out of his neck. The fact that he even made it to the house, that they had enough sense as little kids to say, hey, you know, that could have been horrible. It could have been horrible even on the ambulance ride. It could have been horrible just trying to stop it. And then when they actually found that piece and not knowing if they, you know, what else is in there, it could have been horrible. There are just a couple little ones that are holding on. But here in a second, those little bubbles, the little vapor will be gone. It happened for Tamiko. She was gone. We did her funeral. Thankfully, this dude right here is here. But this shirt gives evidence that that is not a guarantee either. So what do you do? Why are you talking about all this stuff, preacher? You made us cry the other week. Is that no? I want you to have an awakening in your life that some of y'all are spending way too much time in unforgiveness. And you're saying, well, today or tomorrow, I'm going to take care of that. Not right now. I'm still angry. Okay. Your life is a vapor. And there's going to be some unspoken words. Well, I'll tell them about Jesus like you talked about last week. I'll tell them about Jesus, but I got to wait for the right time. When's the right time? When they're no longer here with us and you don't get another opportunity because you wasted your time? When's that going to happen? Well, you know what? I'm going to serve the Lord more. I know I got to get into the Word. And I know I got to, in my family, lead. And I need to be a man of God in my family. When's that going to happen? It's like a little vapor. It's here. And then it's gone. He is here. So we hug him a little tighter. We appreciate the moment a little bit more. We realize just how We're not shooting BB guns against bullets anymore, are we?
No.
We learn, but then we also take advantage of the moment. Stop waiting on a tragedy to happen before you're thankful for life that God has given you. Stop waiting until the right time to serve Him when today is a great day to start doing that. Friends, listen. This man thought he controlled the who, what, when, where, why, and how of his life. And then suddenly, something happened to where it's like, no, your life doesn't even last that long. It is a vapor. It's a vapor for little ones. It's a vapor for old ones. So what are you going to do with every breath that God has given you? Let's live it for the glory of the Lord. Would you bow your head for just a moment? You want to make your way back to your mama, bud? Appreciate you, bud. As we bow our heads for just a moment, I need to ask you today, in just the stillness of this time, have you ever given your life to Jesus Christ? If you haven't, then right now at this very moment, God's will for your life is that you come and that you are saved, that you know Him as your Lord and Savior, that today you might do this, that you might say, Lord, I am a sinner. I need Jesus Christ to save me. I know that He died on a cross for my sins, and today I surrender my life to Him. Friends, it is not about the words, but it is all about the Spirit of God and you being willing to say, I will give my life to Christ this morning. But you're here today and you're watching online and there's been a lot of wasted breaths in your life. Maybe today's your day of commitment that says, Lord, for the rest of my life, may I live it to praise and honor Jesus Christ. Lord, with what you've given me, I surrender it to you today. And so, Lord, today as we come to you, we give this invitation time to you. We offer up our lives to Jesus Christ, and Lord, we say, here, take it. Build our life because we surrender our life to you. So, Lord, move during this invitation time. We can't twist an arm. We can't have anyone else respond. It is just the work of the Spirit of God. And so move here this morning, we ask, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Would you stand for a moment as we respond to the Lord? Brother Drake and I will be up front if you need to make a decision for Christ. We'd love to talk to you about that this morning. Will is to thank Him this morning. Would you do that?
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Together. There is no one.
There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes and wonder.
Show
me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to all the praise we could ever bring.
sing We Live For You. Jesus,
Jesus, the name above every other name.
He is the only one.
Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Let's sing that chorus, folks.
Holy, there is no one like you.
There's none.
There is none beside you.
Open up.
Open up my eyes in wonder.
Show
me who you are and fill me with your heart.
Build my life,
and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm fire,
and I will, here you go,
and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will.
Come on, let's say it one more time. And I will build, come on now.
And I will build my life upon you.
It is a firm.
It is a firm foundation. And I will put my trust in you.
As we close today, Brother Drake is going to lead us in a couple of quick announcements. Brother Reuben will close us in prayer. And then you're going to walk out the door. I'm just trying to make eye contact with you, if you don't mind, real quick. Just real fast. I'm thankful for each of you. And that this is the last opportunity that you and I should have a moment to speak. Give your life to Jesus. Breath is never guaranteed. But if you have it, use it for Him. Use it to represent Him. And then use it to praise His name. If you are glad that you've been here this morning, when bubbles are usually a lot of fun and they are exciting and they are great to know that the Lord is good, would you just thank the Lord for His goodness this morning? Amen. We are thankful. It is a celebration of God's goodness. Amen. Now live it for the Lord Jesus Christ. All right, brother, this is all you. I did that just so you could have some.
Thanks for joining us today at Westside Emmanuel Baptist Church, the church that loves God and loves people.
We want to invite you to come and join us every Sunday morning at 9:15 a.m. for Bible study, 10:30.